Hi everyone, thanks for joining. We're going to get started now. Today we have approximately 1 hour, and just a reminder, one question, one follow-up. We have Dr. Williams and Dr. Brown here today, so I'll turn it over to them for some remarks.
Well, good morning, and it is a morning one. We're doing one this morning at 10 o'clock, so that's for the best timing. I'm pleased to be joined by Dr. Brown, who is going to give us our update on the modeling as well as the projections. And so with that, and then I'm going to have, after the presentation, I'll cover the data points that have transpired since Monday and other updates and comments accordingly. So let's go over to the update on the COVID-19 projections. Over to you, Dr. Brown. Thank you for joining
today. Thank you, Dr. Williams. So we will share a lot of challenging data today. We are in the third wave of the pandemic, and as the new variants spread, you will see that COVID is killing faster and younger. It's spreading far more quickly than it was before, and we cannot vaccinate quickly enough to break this third wave. This is the challenge of the new variants. But I'd like to start today by taking you inside of Ontario's hospitals and sharing what the doctors and nurses working inside our intensive care units are telling us. Whole families are now showing up in intensive care. It used to be that one family member, often an older parent or grandparent, would be in the intensive care unit while other members of the family would have caught a much milder form of the disease, if at all. But with the new variants that are both more contagious and more dangerous, we're seeing situations where whole families end up in intensive care all at the same time. So this gets much more challenging because of the pressure that is already hitting our intensive care units. So even as people are fighting for their lives, we have to separate families in ambulances or helicopters and move them to other regions that have a spare bed. One family ended up spread between three hospitals, one in Simcoe, one in Toronto, and an adult child on a ventilator in a third city. Another family ended up spread between three cities, three different hospitals, and all of them died. And COVID is hitting younger, healthier people. Over 4 days last week, one of the physicians we talked to described critical care notes on a dozen patients fighting COVID-19, all of which said, no past medical history, no medications, no allergies, and so on. Almost all of the patients described in these notes were under the age of 65. Now, this doctor worked through the brunt of the first and the second wave. He told us very clearly that even at the worst of these times, he hadn't seen this many young, otherwise healthy people fighting for their lives against COVID-19. So this is different. But what is not different is that the weapons that we have to fight against COVID-19 still work and work well. Vaccination is the key to long-term control. We're making progress on vaccination, and if we work to focus those vaccines into older Ontarians and into those communities with the highest rates of infection, we can make faster, life-saving progress. Now, this sort of focus is a complex endeavor, but if we're able to pull it off, we will actually have a substantial impact on the number of cases and the eventual health impact of COVID-19 in our province. But vaccination alone is not enough, and it has never been enough as this third wave started. The best weapons we have for short-term control are the public health measures like masks, physical distancing, hand hygiene, staying outside if you need to meet people, and as a last resort, stay-at-home orders. And these measures only work if people understand them and can follow them. These measures are the key to the control of the pandemic now and the time that we need to vaccinate more Ontarians. We need to emphasize their importance. We also need to make it easy for people to follow them and to stay at home when they're sick or they have come into contact with someone who is. Sometimes we talk about public health measures and the economy, or public health measures and mental health as a trade-off. This is a false debate. The faster we get the pandemic under control, the faster we return to normal. Partial measures, half-hearted adherence, and denial prolong the pandemic and make life harder for everyone. And this is particularly true for children and for youth. School infections reflect what is happening in the community. We will present evidence today on the importance of schooling to our economy, to our children's health, and to the fairness of our society. Schools should be the last place to close and the first to open, but as international experience shows, if we don't get the pandemic under control, we will have to take more drastic measures for longer periods of time. If we don't get the pandemic under control, we'll have more sick people, some of whom will never get better. We will further damage our hospital system and the people working in it. We'll have more unnecessary death, and we'll hurt students and our society. We are at a place where our decisions now will make a difference. And as scientists, it's not usually our job to actually offer public health advice, but two pieces I think are so simple and will make such a difference that I'll do so today. The first is to take it outside. See your friends and your family outside. Stay 2 meters away outside. And if you have to be closer, make sure you wear a mask. Second, please get vaccinated. When you're eligible, please do not put that off. And if you can help other people get vaccinated, please do it. Help them book an appointment. Help them get to an appointment. And with that, let's get into the numbers. And my apologies, when we put on the slides, the sign language translation will disappear. It'll return immediately following the presentation. Great. We'll start as we always do on the key messages. So the third wave is here and is being driven by variants of concern. Younger Ontarians are ending up in hospital. Risk of ICU admission is 2 times higher, and the risk of death is 1.5 times higher for patients who are infected with the B.1.1.7 variant. This is the dominant variant of concern right now. It's the variant that was first identified in the United Kingdom. COVID-19 is already impacting our health system's ability to deal with regular ICU admissions, and its continued spread will affect our ability to care for all patients. Vaccination is not reaching yet the highest risk communities, and although this is a complex, challenging endeavor, delaying its impact as an effective strategy really is important to consider, and we need to reach those high-risk communities. School disruptions have a significant and highly inequitable impact on students, parents, and society, and to the extent possible, further disruption should be minimized. And stay-at-home orders will control the surge, they will protect access to care, and they will increase the chance of the summer that Ontarians want. Going to the first slide, you can see here that cases are increasing in most of the public health units, and it is above the red level in most of our public health units. And actually, whether cases are increasing or decreasing in different units, they really do, on average, remain above the control or red level in the framework. So cases are up, and cases are consistently up across the province. You can see in this slide that testing positivity is also up, and at the provincial level, if you look at the black line, it is above, again, the red level, or the control level in the framework. So cases are up. And positivity, the percentage of tests that are positive, is up as well. Now, we always want to consider whether or not this is a function of testing, but as you can see, testing numbers are flat. So, same amount of tests, more of them coming back positive, cases are up overall. This is clearly a third wave of the pandemic, and cases are increasing daily. Now, if you look here, you can see what is driving the increase in cases. The orange line reflects the cases due to the new variants of concern. This is primarily B.1.1.7, the variant that was first identified in the United Kingdom. You can see that is growing very sharply, and that is driving up the overall line, the blue line, in this figure. What you'll see likely over the next little while is the orange line and the blue line get closer and closer until it's really that sharp orange slope that drives the entire volume of infections with the pandemic. And you can see the rate of increase over a 7-day average is quite significant. This is also not only a more contagious disease, it's not more easily transmitted from person to person, it's also a more dangerous disease. In the first and second waves, when we were dealing with the earlier variants, the variants that had been first identified in China, for every 10 patients we might have expected to be hospitalized, now we're expecting to see 16 patients hospitalized. If in the previous first and second wave we had expected to see 10 ICU admissions, we now expect to see 20 ICU admissions among those same sort of groups. And if we're thinking about death, where we might have expected to see 10 deaths, we'll now see 15 deaths. So a substantial increase not only in its ability to transmit from patient to patient or person to person, but also significantly more dangerous and more fatal disease. We have ongoing analysis right now that suggests that the risk of being put on a ventilator is now also 3 times as high with the variants of concern. And I think critical as well that there is a much higher risk of asymptomatic transmission up to 2.5 times greater risk of transmission before symptoms show, which really reinforces the importance of the public health measures like masking and physical distancing so that you don't infect someone when you're unaware that you yourself are infected. I want to move now into the projections with the modeling. I want to talk first a little bit about what these models are based on. We run four separate models across multiple universities. We developed 3 to 5 scenarios reflecting different sets of assumptions for each of these models, and they are consistent in what they're returning. So this is a large group of modelers spread out across the province who are providing really kind of very similar results back now despite very different approaches to the modeling. We've looked at really four scenarios here. The first is as if there was no intervention, if the disease was just spreading. That's the dotted red line. The second is vaccination. That's the solid red line. The third is what we might see with vaccination and a 2-week stay-at-home order that was similar to the order that we saw just after the winter holidays. And the fourth scenario is vaccination plus, or continuing vaccination plus a longer, a 4-week stay-at-home order with the same effectiveness as the stay-at-home order following the winter holidays. We're assuming that the vaccines have about 70% effectiveness. That may be a slight underestimate compared to the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines. It may be roughly where we'd see on average the combination of vaccines we're seeing now. We're assuming that the vaccines are administered at a constant rate, similar to what there is now, so we're assuming no supply interruptions and continued administration. And we're assuming that they're administered randomly. What this does, it likely leads us to a little bit of an underestimate of the growth of cases. But you can see here, under all the scenarios, cases do grow for a little while. However, in both the 2-week and the 4-week stay-at-home order, they do start to break and come down. Although you can see that with the 2-week stay-at-home order, they do start to creep up again as we return to the current level of mobility. We're at the low end range of our last projection, but as you can see, kind of firmly where we thought we would be on the last round. Want to show here what's happening with our hospitalizations and our ICU admissions as we project these cases. You know, really compared to our summer, after the first wave receded, our ICUs never emptied out again. They never recovered. And so you can see really starting back at the beginning of September, at the far left-hand side of this chart, that blue line starts to increase, and it doesn't come back down following the diminution of hospitalizations in the second wave. It's really stayed very steady and is starting to rise again now, which is putting significant strain on the intensive care units. You can also see that the hospitalization rate is increasing quickly as well right now. And we talked that this is really reflecting not only a more contagious and a more dangerous disease, it's also a disease now that with the new variants of concern that attack younger people. Just taking a snapshot, looking just before the winter break, December 14th to 20th, 2020, that was a period when we were very worried about the spread of the disease. You can see that we had about 150 ICU admissions in that week, with about a third of them in people under 60 years of age. You can see now that we are a higher number, over 150 hospitalizations, closer to 160, sorry, ICU admissions in the last week between March 15th to 21st. But you can see that there is a substantial increase in the number of young people admitted into intensive care units. So it's gone from about 30% under the age of 60 to now 46% under the age of 60. So both the proportion and the number of younger people entering our intensive care units are increasing over time, which reflects the changing nature of the variants of concern or the new threat brought by the variants of concern. If you go on now to look at ICU projections, again, you can see it's very heavily based on what happens with the system level public health measures. You can see vaccination there, that's the red line, and you can see the 2-week and the 4-week stay-at-home order. Really, because development of symptoms, hospitalization, and intensive care unit admission all lag the actual infection, lag the identification of cases, you can see here that actually we start to bring down the intensive care unit occupancy, but it does take longer than merely bringing down the cases. And what we don't have here is a long enough projection to show the difference between the 2 and the 4 week. If we did show a longer projection, which is always challenging looking out past a month or 6 weeks, you would see that the four-week empties out and reduces ICU occupancy much more significantly than the two-week stay at home. Looking here, you can see the access to care deficit that's continuing to build across the province. We've presented weekly figures here to give a little bit more granularity to the data, a little more detail to the data. You can see that we're up about 250,000 cases, really still a very high number in procedures that have been delayed, canceled, or postponed. This is important because at some point these procedures will need to be performed. They do reflect people with ill health who are going to benefit, sometimes in a life-saving way from surgery. And I think what's important to know is we've been able to look now at the level of the least urgent cases, and these seem to be consistent over time. And so this is not a buildup of a truly discretionary or optional surgery or elective surgery. This is a buildup of all types of surgery, but predominantly urgent surgery that people need. Want to continue to focus in on the impact of the variants of concern. We've talked a lot about how rates are highest in those communities that have the highest proportion of essential workers, people who need to go to work every day, who cannot work from home. We've talked about how rates are highest in those communities with unsuitable housing. These are generally racialized and marginalized communities. And you can see here once again, these communities are bearing the brunt of the pandemic. The red bars there represent the top third of communities by the proportion of people living in those communities who are engaged in essential work. It's about 51% growth in infection with the variants of concern. Compare that to the lowest third of people, lowest third of communities where people are engaged in essential work. That's about 19% growth. So a substantially higher growth rate in these communities. This is really important for thinking about how we make sure that we support people in these communities, we get vaccination and other initiatives into these communities to support control of the pandemic. As you see here, we are expanding first dose coverage, but it remains complete. If you look here, you can see a substantial increase beyond 1,500 first doses of vaccines. But 80 years and older, this is community living, people living in the community, not in long-term care homes, at 70% incomplete, either not having had a dose or not having an appointment for a dose. 70 to 79 years, that's 40% incomplete. You know, 40% of people have not had a dose and do not have an appointment. And as we get down to lower age groups, 70 to 74 years, 72% incomplete still. And so in the sort of age groups that are perhaps still the most vulnerable, you can see there is a high number, a high proportion of people who haven't had a vaccine and do not have an appointment for a vaccine. And I think it's important here to talk as well about how this breaks down not only by age, but also looking at the risk of infection. So we've shown data in previous technical briefings that show the very big difference in the rate of infection across communities. Again, you know, thinking about this in terms of communities based on the proportion of people engaged in essential work. But if you walk through this chart very carefully, and I'm sorry for all the numbers, you'll see that older age groups are being vaccinated more, which is what we wanted to see, but we are not vaccinating more in the highest risk communities. So for instance, if you look at the top left-hand corner, that top cell there in green is the proportion of people over 80 who have been vaccinated who live in communities with the highest rate of infection. That's 50%. If you walk across the table to the right-hand side in the same row, you'll see the number 70%. That means that in the oldest age group, in the lowest rate of infection communities, 70% of people have been vaccinated. So a higher percentage of people in those communities at the lowest risk of being vaccinated compared to people living in the highest risk communities. If you go to the bottom of the chart and look at the overall total, you'll see again this difference, 8% in the highest risk communities, but 13% in the lowest risk communities. Now, it is important to recognize that getting vaccines to where they're needed the most can be a complex endeavor. There's a number of tools and initiatives that can help, but it requires a lot of planning and a lot of support. So I'm not saying that this is an easy target, but it's an important target to pursue as we try to get vaccines where they will have the greatest impact in our communities. And this is the last slide. This is data really sort of reflecting international experience here. We don't have Ontario data, but I believe this is relevant to what we're seeing here. If you look at the right-hand panel, you'll see that with school interruptions, with the types of disruptions that we see to schools and to primary or elementary and secondary schools here and around the world, there is a significant loss in learning with these interruptions. And that's important to note because this is not only a loss in educational attainment, it also reflects a drop in lifetime earnings for these people in all likelihood. It results in an estimated drop in GDP. It is associated with significant stress and distress, both physical and mental health. And like everything in this pandemic, it is incredibly inequitably distributed, where those communities that have the least ability to adapt to these changes are often those that are already most heavily affected by it. And so what this really presents is a picture that, as we're starting to think about priorities, if we are putting priority on student achievement, student mental health, and students' future, schools should be the last to close and the first to open in any public health measure. And it really starts to reflect schooling as a form of essential work. With that, I'll close on the key findings. So the third wave is here. The growth in cases is real. This is not only a more transmissible disease, it's also a more dangerous disease with a higher risk of ICU admission, a higher risk of death, a higher risk of hospitalization, and a higher risk of intubation or being put on a ventilator, and perhaps, as worrisome, a much higher risk of asymptomatic transmission that really reinforces the importance of masking and physical distancing. This is already damaging our ability, our health system's ability to deal with regular ICU admissions. Remember, these are not elective admissions to an intensive care unit, and our ability to care for all patients. Although it's challenging, vaccination is not reaching the highest risk communities, and this delays its impact as an effective strategy. School disruptions have a significant and highly inequitable impact on students, on parents, and society, and so we must really, I think, work if we're looking to maximize health to further to minimize further disruptions. And however, challenging stay-at-home orders will control the surge, they will protect access to necessary care and emergency care, and they will increase the chance of the summer that I think we all want to see. If they're not, we will likely see the pandemic continue on in a way that damages our hopes for the summer. And I'll just stop here. You know, the work that we're presenting here today is supported by over 120 scientists working as volunteers from across the province, spread out across most of our research-intensive universities and institutes. Today we've had dozens of contributed material directly into the presentation. With that, Dr. Williams, I'll turn it back to you.
Well, thank you, Dr. Brown. And you can see by the sober numbers and issues there that were the data's reporting, as well as testimonials from various healthcare providers, to understand the change and shift that has been witnessed over the last week or two, that is not only increasing severity but increasing in rapidity. And we'll comment about that in a moment in there. So a lot of work in by the scientific and academics, and thank you for all the work they've done. It's invaluable, and I'll have some comments to make from our public health practitioners as well, from our public health measures table, after I give you the data updates for today. And I think when we give you the data updates, it's important to see the changing pace of what things are happening. And that's when most concerning to myself and to our public health measures table, and no doubt, as demonstrated by Dr. Brown and their table, the scientific group seen that trend as well. So we've seen the change in shifting, and we knew that with the variants that we are experiencing. So let's look at that. Since last Monday, we've seen an additional 7,226 cases of COVID-19. And if you do some comparisons, we had 2,336 cases on Tuesday, 2,333 cases on Wednesday, about the same. Today, we're reporting 2,557, and that's the highest we've had for quite a while. The 7-day average that we've seen is that we have 2,341. That's compared to last week, which was 1,749, and even the week before that, it was 1,427. In the past, we saw that increase, as in the 2 weeks ago, of about 200 to 300 a day, a week. Now this is a doubling of that within 1 week, 600 increase. So the pace of increase is moving at a faster rate. When we look back at the month of March, Ontario averaged 1,583 cases, and that is almost, at average, is half the month was significantly higher than the first half. So the second half has really taken off. And that's the point, is that when you look at that, we'll compare that with testing. And I know what Dr. Brown has mentioned to me before, but I'll emphasize that in a moment. In the period March 16 to 31, the daily average was 1,908, the first half of the month, compared to 1,237 in the latter half. So if we look at things there, we see actually more, I'm sorry, I had those reversed. We had 1,908 in the latter half and 1,237 in the first half. That means that we've seen an increase in the average extensively in the latter half of March. We've seen reporting additional deaths, 52, and that means it includes 23 today. The 7-day average for deaths has increased, again, up to 16 from 11 in the last week. And the number of patients in the hospital ICU have been showing increases. And so now we have 1,116 people currently hospitalized with a diagnosis of COVID-19. And our ICU number in the data reporting is up to 464. That's higher than we reached in the second wave. So our system, as Dr. Brown has alluded to, is under stress considerably. Our testing, like even today, we did 62,290 tests, and the positivity today is 4.8%. In the second wave, we did peak around 6.8%. The other thing that's interesting to note, and it's important to note, is that sometimes the percent positivity goes up as the volume goes down, but the volume of testing has remained the same, and the number of cases we're getting hospitalized is going up. So this change is not due to a shift in larger testing volumes, it's just more cases overall. And that's an important one to recognize. So the lab testing has the daily average of 49,558. So the average percent positivity for March, for 1 to the 15th of March, was 2.8%, whereas in the latter half, we went up to 4.4%. Again, we're seeing a considerable shift and the ramping up, as was predicted by the modelers, that we would see with the incoming and exacerbation of the variants of concern. Talking about the variants of concern, as I said, we are now confirmed 2,116, and Ontario has an addition of 22,371 cases where the mutation, namely the 501, and there's other ones we're identifying now, have been detected. The largest increase we're seeing is in the B117, the so-called one that was identified first in the UK, and that we've seen an increase of 34% in that number just over the past week. The P1, or the so-called Brazilian one, has also seen an increase. While smaller numbers, and remember the B117 is a 34% increase on a large number to start with, whereas the P1 is a 78% increase in itself, but that's a smaller number. Nevertheless, it is a 78% increase week over week. And that shows you it's starting to exponentially increase as well. So we have to be concerned. The 7-day rolling average for the VOCs is now up to 60.6%, which is up from 53.8% a week ago. So the percent is climbing and is now the dominant, as the modelers said it would be. And the lines, as Dr. Brown has shown the graphs, are starting to converge together and become mostly the variants of concern. So what does that mean? We've looked at this, and all along we have been, over the last 3 to 4 weeks, as we saw changes in our health units in the 34, if they were moving up quickly, even a slight amount, we were quick to move them and put them into higher levels of restriction. More had gone into the so-called gray lockdown zone, and others are into the red restrict areas. So we have kept doing that, or control areas, I should say. And the cases have continued to increase. Our numbers of cases per 100,000 in the province, we were at 70 72.3 a week ago. We're now at 93.6 this week, and that data isn't even updated, which we'll get today. And it could push us over 100,000 for the whole province. That means getting closer to the old overall level of a gray lockdown type scenario. We also watched the hospitalizations and the ICU occupancy, and that has been increasing rapidly and is posing a greater threat to our healthcare system. And you've heard commentary from the practitioners who are in the thick of that and the front line dealing with this issue day in and day out, as well as the administrators who are trying to manage that in Ontario Health with moving critical patients around to balance the load, because it doesn't happen equally throughout the province. But as we're seeing in our cases of outbreaks and that over the last 3 or 4 weeks, no part of the province has been without the impact of outbreaks, including gray zones in the northwest and the northeast part of the province. At the same time, we are making progress with immunization. We now have well over 2 million, and now we're starting with our larger volumes of vaccine arriving in the province. We are hoping, and the plan is that we are getting up over 80,000, like to be over 100,000 vaccinations a day. That's a great endeavor, and we hope to be able to achieve that with all the partners involved, whether it's our public health units, primary care physicians, volunteers, pharmacists, everybody on board to do what they need to do to get in this race, and that's what we're talking about today, to keep things under control while the vaccinations get caught up. The difference I've seen between the second wave and this wave is that the most common cases were in the over 80s. Right now, they're the lowest. That shows you the impact of our vaccination programs. Nearly complete, not totally complete yet, as Dr. Brown alluded to, and we need the rest of those people to come out and to get their vaccination undertaken. And now moving down with different age groups and successfully keeping impacting that as we go along. So we want to be able to put in recommendations to the decision makers, and I'll be meeting or having a session later on with the Premier to announce some changes that'll be forthcoming, taking on the recommendations from the science table and those of our practitioners, public health experts in practice of public health, who concur that strident steps need to be undertaken to put the province at large into more of a closed down scenario. So we made recommendations to the Cabinet and the Premier and the Minister of Health, and we'll be making some announcements on those later on today. The key aspect here, and you've noted what Dr. Brown has said, that this variant versions, the various ones, have a higher level of, someone used the words virulence, certainly much more infectious, and you can see how it moves right through groups, including families, that are impacted by it. Not impacted with saying they felt unwell, that they have to go to the emergency department, and unfortunately some, as we find more and more of the younger people, without comorbidities, without other issues behind them and medications, move quickly into being almost put in, intubated and put in the ICU right from the emergency department. So they come in more acute and more critical. And so that means then people who felt before that the COVID was sort of an issue to be taken lightly, it is not to be taken lightly. And so you have to be very careful about your personal behavior. No matter what level you're in now or what level we end up with recommendations to the Cabinet and to the Minister of Health and Premier, where we announce today, you still have to be personally vigilant. Yes, you can go outside, and we want you outside, and you can do things outside, but you still cannot be casual, as in gathering and having chats and groups with less than 6 feet apart with no masking, a very dangerous and bad decision to undertake. Because a lot of those people you're talking to, at the time they're incubating, will not be presenting with symptoms. They may say they were totally well. So you can't tell just because of what the person says to you. So you have to maintain your personal precautions, except among the ones, your household, who you've been with for an extended period of time, and you know what each other's exposure and behavior has been. So no matter which level and how we arrive at this, we have to give ourselves more time. More time to get the vaccinations done. More time to get more vaccines in. And more time to protect larger parts. We are seeing the vaccinations highly effective. We've seen our rates in our long-term care facilities, our retirement homes come down quickly and extensively and staying down. It does work. And so we want to make sure that everyone has protection and then collectively we can bring this down, relieve the pressure on our hospitals and ICUs, keep our schools open, and also at the same time look for a better summer and fall. So this is the investment. It's the focus time for the next number of weeks ahead to keep focused on this, keep your protection, be stringent on that. And because while you wait for your vaccine, you can protect yourself, you can protect your family. If you do what's right, do it again, do it consistently, and take this whole issue very seriously. So those are my comments. And with that, we open up to the media for questions.
We'll go to the phone lines. Just a reminder, one question, one follow-up. Over to the first question, please.
Your first question comes from John McGrath with TVO. Please go ahead.
Dr. Brown, you sat there 6 weeks ago and warned us all this was coming if policy measures weren't taken. They weren't taken, and now we're here. You've been relatively stoic in these briefings, but I'm wondering how you feel today. Are you frustrated? Are you angry about this outcome?
No. I'm just hopeful that if the goal is to reduce the infection and the impact of this disease, that the measures we take are strong enough to make sure that we can get the disease under control, we can protect our hospitals, and we can get back to a normal life as quickly as possible.
Follow up?
Dr. Williams, this is a failure. This is a policy failure. We were warned about the third wave. We have failed to avoid it. Who is responsible for this failure? Did you give the cabinet bad advice, or did the cabinet fail to follow better advice that the public wasn't made aware of?
So I'd have to first say I don't agree it's a failure. All along we said, receiving the advice, that we would have to monitor the situation. We have to increase our monitoring of the variants. We have to make recommendations, as we did each week from my table to the cabinet, to move more quickly, to put more health units into areas of lockdown, which we did, and increase the restrictions on each one all the way through. Those policy and regulations were enhanced and moved on as rapidly as possible. If you recall, the original projection is that if we didn't do anything today, we would be at 5,000 to 6,000 cases a day. We are not there. Would we like to be less than 2,000? Yes, I'd like to be less than. We would like to flatten the curve and not have a curve. So while we have made decisions and have success at it, the variants have moved in steadily and progressed there. So we have made some indent. We have slowed the rise. Not adequate, in my mind, to bring it under. So we have to take more stringent actions. And that's what we're planning to do and to put some things in place today. So I see these as always, it's a progressive, and you're continually making policy decisions and bringing those in levels and steps as appropriate at the time. And we have this level. Some other provinces are in much higher percent positivity. That's nothing to put to your to rest on. We want to bring it down even further, and as we get our vaccination program in place. So this is all part of the overall process of dealing with a changing and moving variant with a lot of variables within the community and structures that you have to learn to be nimble and to adapt to and work with.
Next question.
Your next question comes from Jessica Smith with Queen's Park Briefing. Please go ahead.
Hi, thanks so much for taking my question. Dr. Brown, the chart on ICUs, it shows 800 COVID patients in ICUs, right? Sort of no matter what happens. What does that actually mean for patient care? Can Ontario handle that?
I know that, you know, the doctors and the nurses working in the intensive care units and the managers of the hospital, the leaders of the hospitals will do everything they can to make sure that they deal with all patients. But when you get to that, you know, we talked initially about 150 beds being a threshold at which we start to see some surgery impacted. We talked about 300 beds being a much more a worrisome threshold where you really start to kind of have to move people around. And 800 is a place where we are not able to provide all of the care as well as we would want to people. And I don't mean to be, I don't mean to sort of use strong language, but that is a place where clinicians need to make hard decisions that you'd never want them to have to make, where you will see loss of life and where you will see the sorts of challenges that we've seen in northern Italy, that we've seen in New York, that we've seen in other jurisdictions where the hospitals have filled up, as you're seeing now in France and in other countries.
To follow up, are you talking about implementing the triage protocol will likely be necessary?
I think that's a decision that's really the best up to the clinicians working in the IMSs and the regional sort of centers to manage that, but it's a definite possibility.
And I would add to that is that we're have been, even in the fall, looking at our capacity. We have increased our capacity with so the original ones that we had the numbers on. We've added more ICU beds into our capacity with the Vaughan Cortellucci Hospital and other ones put into the system. We have looked at aspects around mobile-type facilities and how that might be handled. So Ontario Health, combined with the ministry and other sectors, are working with different experts and CEOs to look at how to get the maximum out of our facilities, look at the issues around facilities as well as HHR, human health resources, because you need staff to staff those as well as have them. So all this is being looked at, but we'd rather we didn't have to push to that number. That's why the steps that have to be taken have to be taken seriously at this time to bend the curve and keep it down while we wait for the vaccinations to catch up.
Next question.
Your next question comes from Laura Stone with the Globe and Mail. Please go ahead.
Hi, doctors. I'd like to hear from both Dr. Brown and Dr. Williams on this. The modeling talks about stay-at-home orders. Stay-at-home orders will control the surge, and it looks like that's what the modeling takes into account. From what we understand of what the government is doing, they are not doing stay-at-home orders. So, Dr. Williams, is this what you recommended? And Dr. Brown, do you have modeling projections for what happens without a stay-at-home order?
Answer the first question about the modeling.
Sure.
So the modeling that we've done today or that we've shown today reflects a stay-at-home order with the same impact as what you saw after the winter holidays. I think if you're unable to get that level of impact, you're going to see faster, you're not going to see the same reduction in cases, you're not going to see the same control over ICU admissions.
And I would add that I think what they're comparing to is that how did it work when we had the stay-at-home order in place? The key point there is that mobility. And Dr. Brown in the past has presented, as well as we have presented, the mobility issues and people moving around from areas of high levels of community transmission to lower levels, sometimes seeking facilities or services that they can't get in their areas of restriction, not only share some of their retail powers, but they also then spread variants of concern. And our big concern with our recommendations and issues, well, how do you decrease and limit that kind of mobility so that people will stay home, stay locally, because stay at home, we're not trying to say you can't go outside the house. we want you to be go outdoors, as Dr. Brown said, you can take it outdoors. So it would be unusual to say go outdoors, but don't stay inside the house at the same time. We want to be clear on that. And that's especially important as we come up to this. I was going to mention that with the weekend coming ahead and while people have had historically times to socially gather, you're going to have to adhere to those limitations. You can have an outdoor, if the weather is amenable, 6 feet distancing. In your area there, and to protect yourself and the household, keep it with no just your household in the home, and to do those things. So plan them out. You can still do virtual, you can do other things than that, but do it carefully. And you can do a number of things outdoors, but still respecting the distance and the masking. So I think that's the key difference I would say, is that in the middle of winter, it was easier to stay at home because it was not that pleasant, but some people did very well and went out jogging at minus 10 or minus 20 degrees. On their own, we still want people to do outdoor activities coming up over the next number of weeks and to ensure that that happens.
Follow up.
Okay, thanks. And can you talk about schools? We're not expecting schools to close. The minister has said they're proceeding with the April break and schools will return. you know, I think there's a lot of concern about the situation in schools right now. So what are you seeing in schools, Dr. Brown? Are they a risky environment? What needs to be done? And can you just expand on your thoughts on keeping schools open?
So schools really reflect the level of infection in the community. And this is, I think, important to kind of recognize that if infection takes off in the community, the schools amplify this. This is a very, very, very hard trade-off. We know that if schools stay open, we will see more infection, but we also know that the impact on children of these interruptions in schooling is really hard and damaging. So it's a challenging trade-off. What I think I'd probably say overall, and something we said regularly, is the more decisive you are early on, the more that you work to get the infection under control, the more that everything moves along quickly. But I would say if there is room for choices, schools would be the last things that I would at least personally recommend closing, and I'd be the first ones to, it'd be the first things to open up again.
And I would add to that 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 was, you know, I've heard that clearly from the science table. I've heard it from experts, whether it's pediatricians or psychologists, psychiatrists, child-centered, as well as developmental workers. Different ones have spoken strongly about the value and need to have the schools remain open, and our public health measures table has strongly ratified that position. We are seeing over the last number of weeks, like we did prior to the winter holiday break, while our schools kept the rates inside and the transmission inside the schools down, and our recent wide surveys of schools has demonstrated lower than 1% still in there, and while we have a number of schools declare outbreak with one person or two declared, to be on the careful side there, the amount of transmission within the schools has been quite limited. But more and more are coming with symptomatology and going to get tested. So more and more students are being identified prior to coming into the school with positivity. Why? Because as Dr. Brown alluded to, when you have that amount of community transmission, it's only going to be about obvious that children will be picking up, and they do pick up and carry the variants of concern more readily. And we've seen that in the UK situation. And so we're finding with our one symptom testing, more and more are being identified positive along with their family members. And unfortunately, some of the staffing in the institutions are also coming in with positivity from the community sector. So we have our protection things in place, and we'll be endeavoring to try and keep our schools open. And that's part of why we have to put some more restrictions in place, not just for the hospital sector, as I said before, because we want to keep our schools open. As Dr. Brown, I would agree, they're the last one to close and the first one to open up again as things work along. So that is our endeavor, and that'll be what I'm seeking to work with and our team working with, both with the Ministry of Education and with the Minister of Education. Our schools have been safe, and we want to keep them safe.
Last question.
Your final question comes from Cynthia Mulligan with City News. Please go ahead.
Hello, doctors. I was wondering if I could ask you about the vaccine rollout. Has it been flawed? I mean, we see in the modeling that elder people in higher risk communities aren't getting vaccinated as faster. A, is that a problem? Essential workers, should we be turning our attention more to them? Look at the Amazon plant, you know, should vaccinations been sent right in there? Have we failed on this front?
So, I mean, we would like to be vaccinating everybody all the time. I'd like to be receiving 1 to 2 million doses of vaccine a week, and we could deliver that. I have full confidence we could move up well beyond 100,000. We have been moving through our highest vulnerable, which was identified not only by experts, but also by our National Advisory Committee on Immunization, by our federal counterparts and other province and territories, that age and high-risk groups, especially those in Congress, were the first thing. So you have to do with your highest priority. That was our first phase. And we've been undertaking to achieve that, whether it's our remote First Nation communities, our long-term care facilities, the staffing in those facilities, retirement homes, and other Congress settings as we move through, trying as quickly as we can to get as many done as soon as possible, looking at some other high-risk group that may arise with outbreaks and that, to make sure that if there's things happening in some of our jurisdictions, we give them extra vaccine to try to address target populations. Mobile clinics are being established that are going into areas, as Dr. Brown has alluded to, that have these high-risk concentration and transmission of populations, generally with a higher or lower SCE, social economic status, more essential workers there, larger families and in extended family gatherings with more transmission possible. So we're continuing to drive at those ones there. We have many groups that are identifying they want to be prioritized, and we would like to get to everybody as quickly as we can. The limiter there right now is the amount of vaccine flowing in, and we are trying to ramp it up even now as our supply of Pfizer has picked up. Moderna, we're still waiting to make sure that that will get back on track. And then we're trying to get our new supply came in of the AstraZeneca, and we're still trying to make great inroads on anyone over in the age groups that we have determined in there. We have a lot of work with our pharmacist partners who have pretty well used up all their present stock, but we have more coming in, so we hope to refurbish them and have them take off, and with even more pharmacists signing on daily to get out and get more people in, especially at this time in the 55-plus group, and see how we can make impacts. Right now we're trying to get all our over 60s, and we want to keep driving all those. So I don't think the program has failed. I think the issue is moving as stringently as you can, not vaccines sit in fridges for a long time, get into the arms, as General Hillier in his last day has always been promoting, I would agree, and try and get as many done as to the right people in the right time in the right way, and try and find those ones that we're missing, and some of those ones in those categories, like the over 80s, out in the community that may either not be able to get out or not sure to go out. We're asking our primary care team to get involved in that as well. And maybe some need help to get booked, and you can help them that way. Some are not that adept. While it's for some of the younger people saying it was pretty easy, some of the older ones say, I found it a bit confusing. So you can help them in many ways to do that, because we want them done and to complete those processes. So it is a dynamic process, trying to undertake to vaccinate twice over for most of the vaccines thus far. 14.8 million people. We can't do the children yet, but we know they're making headway on that. So we at least want to get that done. So this is a huge undertaking. And it'll have its bumps in the road, as General Hillier talks about, but they're bumps, and we'll perform and get on that and keep progressing. So get booked, show up, get vaccinated, help the ones who can't, make sure they get there, and identify those that are of concern. And if there's issues, we want to know, and we want to try and resolve those.
Follow up, and this is the last question.
Thank you. Maybe Dr. Brown, you could weigh in on this. We know where the highest risk is. It's not just all 50-year-olds or 60-year-olds. We know there are certain groups of that age category that face higher risk than others. And yet it seems across the board we're just lowering the age category. Should we be fine-tuning it more to those age groups that are higher risk above the same age group?
So it's really a ground game right now. You need to use innovative techniques. You need to support people in getting out to the vaccines. You need to make sure that it gets where it's going to have the biggest impact. That'll differ across each of the public health units, but there are options that we can use, mobile clinics, visiting apartment complexes where there's lots of seniors, moving vaccination clinics into communities, running them longer, a variety of techniques that, although they can be challenging and hard and require constant local adaption, can actually increase the payoff from the amount of vaccination we're doing.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.